Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line.
The term the Eastern Seaboard liberal establishment is often used even by highly sophisticated folk, and the phrase is not without meaning. Several years ago, we inquired on this program whether the Council on Foreign Relations is the nerve ganglion of the establishment, and concluded, or at least I did, that it was not. Today, we will have a look at the New York Times, about which Mr. Russ Braley, one of our guests, has written a book called Bad News, The Foreign Policy of the New York Times. Way back in 1959, the late Richard Rovere, who wrote, by the way, a wonderful spoof on the establishment for Esquire magazine, wrote in London, quotes, "Without the Times, no one with any professional concern with events as they unfold can function in his accustomed way. There are few writers on public affairs who do not work on the comfortable assumption the Times will call to their attention anything that they want called to their attention. There is, in a word, no doubting the eminence of the nation's leading newspaper, the target of Mr. Braley's book. Russ Braley was born in Seattle, graduated from the University of Washington, went soon to Europe where he attended the Sorbonne. He worked for Stars and Stripes, then for many years served as foreign correspondent for the New York Daily News, taking early retirement in 1982 to write this book. Midge Decter, a prominent critic and author, is herself much taken by the pathology of opinion formation, in particular trendy opinions. She is a leading neoconservative, as they call themselves who have not quite made it up the ladder to plain old conservative. She graduated from the University of Minnesota, attended the Jewish Theological Seminary, has been editor of Mainstream, managing editor of Commentary, editor of the Hudson Institute, and editor of Harper's and Saturday Review, a senior editor of the firm of Basics Books, and she is now the principal, manager of the Committee for a Free World. She is the author of several books, including Liberal Parents, Radical Children. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Braley what it is he has identified as the two major concerns of the editorial board of the New York Times over the past generation.
Before I get into that, I should mention that this isn't targeted directly at the Times, this book. It's a pretty big book, as you noticed, and I blame the Times in large part for a situation in which this country had a single-voiced journalism for a number of years. For about 10 years, there was no opposition voice in this country, practically none, with perhaps the exception of your magazine. You could not express a contrary point of view in this country from about 1973 till around 1980, on a number of subjects. So, and I blame the Times for a large part of this, but I also blame the rest of the media for letting the Times get away with it. The Times has, in the period covered by the book, gradually become more and more ideological in the sense that it would support just about any and all revolutions, and it would not stand for any kind of contradiction. Those are the main points.
Now, when you say that a hegemony was introduced in 1973 for about 7 years, are you saying that hegemony was introduced about matters concerning which there ought not to have been hegemonic thought? Because, for instance, I might say approximately after 1965, America became single-voiced on the matter of civil rights. And I think I would be substantially correct. There were no longer newspaper people in the South who spoke in favor of Jim Crow. But you are making a distinction between a consensus normally arrived at and one imposed.
That's right.
Now, what, by what?
Specifically on the Vietnam War and those people, countries, organizations, and movements allied in an attitude toward the Vietnam War, and on Watergate.
Well, by 73, we had pulled out of Vietnam with only rather attenuated commitments, which weren't serviceable in 1975. But as I remember, there were prominent newspapers in 1975 that called on us to redeem those commitments. Are you saying that didn't happen?
I don't think that there were very many and very forceful ones. And on the Watergate part side of the equation, which is to me all one equation, Watergate and the Vietnam War went together as ham and eggs go together. One of the chapters in the book is that Watergate was a foreign affair. By that I meant that the origins of Watergate and the passion aroused by Watergate was a passion not directed specifically against the instances of Watergate, but against the administration that continued to pursue the Vietnam War against the advice of the New York Times and its allies.
Well, Ms. Decter, let me ask you, do you think this kind of a tendency to anthropomorphize what was certainly a trend in the making in the New York Times works, or is it simply convenient?
Well, I wonder if you haven't ascribed too much power to the New York Times. I am one of those people described in your introduction who find that I don't get through the day or can't even commence the day before I've read the New York Times, knowing full well that things that I am reading have been selected and being in a state of irritation every morning. Nevertheless, I still find that there's something makes it difficult for me to get on until I've read the New York Times. But I think the importance of the Times and the power of the Times has to do with the fact that it speaks for the conversation which is going on in the centrally powerful community, rather than that it is exerting that power itself.
The point I made about the Council on Foreign Relations, if you get prominent enough, you get invited to be a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. But it's not because it is generating a point of view, but rather it is co-opting to membership people whose points of view are similar. Is that right?
Yes. I think that would apply here. It is true. I agree with you that dissent and controversy, which the American press pretends that it is in love with, was a very, very difficult thing to carry on. I don't know if I would date it from 1972. In my own experience, I think it set in somewhat earlier than that, but I don't know how to date it. That is certainly true. And no doubt the Times played a very influential role in that, but still, it seems to me that it was reflecting the closing ranks of the American liberal community and refusing to allow its own members to take a dissenting point of view.
Well, the second half of the title of the book is of the foreign policy of the New York Times. So all of my criticisms of the Times are restricted to foreign policy alone and not to anything else. I don't condemn the crossword puzzle. I think it's excellent. I can't get along without the business section. I read the business section of the Times every day. Now, this country has such puts a low priority on foreign policy. We have been isolationist. When I grew up in an isolationist America, for about a dozen years we were non-isolationist, and we were on the top of the world after World War II, until about where this book begins, at Suez in Hungary. We were on top of the world. We were welcome everywhere. We were the models for the rest of the world at that time, and we blew it. We threw it all away. Now, and this is only in foreign affairs that I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the economy. I'm not talking about any of those things that I don't understand. I'm only talking about foreign affairs. I lived overseas half my life. I think I know how the people in a number of countries respond. In this book, there are five Middle East wars, for example. When I was overseas, I was over there about 27 years. Almost every year, I went to East Europe. I visited all of the countries of Eastern Europe except Bulgaria and Albania. And I used to go to East Germany, say, once a year. One of the phrases that came up in the 60s that really bugged me was, in the liberal establishment, you could not say anti-communist without saying primitive anti-communist. And the word primitive was meant to mean that anybody who was an anti-communist was someone who didn't know anything about communism. Well, I know something about communism. I've watched the development or the non-development in the communist countries over there for a long period of time. And I dug out all the books and I read as much Lenin as I could stand and as much Rosa Luxemburg and as much of the rest of them. And I know something about communism, and so however primitive I may be in other respects, I'm not a primitive anti-communist.
Now, are you saying that the word primitive anti-communist is associated with the New York Times at this point?
No, I wouldn't blame that entirely on the Times. I would say that probably started being used by television commentators before it was used by anybody else, but then it got picked up very quickly. I wouldn't blame that particular one on the New York Times. But that was the attitude of the New York Times.
I see a difficulty talking about this general line here, in that indeed one can find the Walter Durantes and the Herbert Matthews who completely distorted Stalin and then subsequently Castro. But then you can also find the others. You can find Abe Rosenthal on Poland. You can find Henry Kam on the South East Asia. The hugeness of the New York Times is it makes it extremely difficult to impute to it a line in its reportorial columns. This is different from the editorial pages. Not the whole world knows that. They do, of course, those who read your book.
Well, in my book, I mentioned, I think, that the best foreign correspondent in the country is Henry Kam, the person that you also noticed,
yeah,
too. I certainly agree that there are great foreign correspondents on the New York Times. They don't get out there and sell the bestsellers. They don't get the columns. They don't get the big play. It's the David Halberstams and the Seymour Hirsch's and
David Halberstam got his biggest play after he resigned from the Times, didn't he?
Pardon?
He got his biggest play after he resigned from the Times, didn't he?
Well, he did, really, yes.
And Arthur Kroc was a columnist, extremely influential, and he was hardly a...
Yes, but the Times promoted and built Halberstam and Seymour Hirsch. A.M. Rosenthal, whom you respect so much, I believe called Hirsch the hottest journalistic property in the United States.
He was, I think.
Well, that was an accurate term. He was certainly a hot property.
Yeah, that's right.
And also, Mr. Rosenthal was in charge of the Times at the time when it was exerting its most, to use a little hyperbole, its most totalitarian domination of the press during the during the period of Watergate, when in cooperation with the Washington Post, which led the way in Watergate specifically, a lot of monkey business was put over on the American public that it is still swallowing to this day in many cases. As I said, it's not only about the Times, the book. I live now near Washington. And I find the Washington Post inflicted upon me almost every day. A couple of months ago, they had an anniversary of Nixon's resignation celebrated in the Washington Post. It was really a very quiet celebration, considering the size of the event that they were celebrating. But they brought up a whole page of things like the Houston Plan. Now, do you remember the Houston Plan?
Very well.
The Houston Plan in the New York Times and in the Washington Post, and especially by Joe Kraft and some people like that, the Houston Plan was a plan to make a police state out of the United States. Now, does anybody believe that anymore? Someone evidently does. There it was, right there on the Washington Post, a whole half page.
The Houston Plan dealt with how to handle the San Francisco, the convention which was then scheduled for San Diego. It involved the use of wiretaps, involved the use of prostitutes. And
No. You're mixing up the Houston Plan with Libby's.
I know the author of the Houston Plan extremely well. He was a former president of Young Americans for Freedom.
That wasn't the Houston Plan as presented in the New York Times. It was three documents that were written by William Sullivan, and the Houston Plan was a plan to coordinate the intelligence activities of the different parts of the, we're talking about two different things, obviously.
Oh yes, well, you were talking about the FBI plan. I was not.
Yeah,
The plan of Houston, who worked for the White House.
No, but I was talking, what the Houston Plan was, three secret documents leaked to the New York Times, which constituted a reorganization of the intelligence services of the United States. And what it actually asked for was that they coordinate their activities at a time when Hoover would not talk to the CIA and this sort of thing. It later came out that the Houston Plan was not written by Houston, the young man that you knew so well, but the Houston Plan was actually the work of William Sullivan of the FBI. Mm-hmm. Now, that was the Houston Plan that Joe Kraft, the New York Times, and the one that was recently talked about in the Washington Post again, as though still to this day someone in the Washington Post believes that was a plan.
Let's try to make a few distinctions here. Yeah. And give me a hand, Mr. Decter. Certain quote fascistic tendencies can be ascribed to a particular president without imputing the desire for fascism to him. Now, it is true that a hate list was got up by Nixon, was it not? It is true that John Dean wrote a memorandum talking about, what was that awful phrase, the something the incumbency, terrible phrase, maximizing the incumbency, yeah. And it is true, as we know, that Mr. Nixon, in fact, he really left office on that account, sought to stop an investigation by the use of executive power, which was clearly illegal. Now, that was not invented by the New York Times. If we could look back and say Mr. Nixon would not, in normal circumstances, have been chased out of office, then I think you would have a more convincing case than you now do. Do you agree with me or not?
Yes. I think it's more useful to step back a little bit. Vietnam and the tendency always to favor revolutions, it seems to me, first of all, are more significant as foreign policy issues. I think from the distance of this perspective, you can say that Watergate was a successful attempt by the American press, and particularly its two powerful institutions, the Washington Post and the New York Times, to topple an American president. Richard Nixon, whom the liberal community had always hated from many, many years back. There was a kind of getting even with him going on, and particularly after he won this enormous landslide election. But it seems to me that there's a cultural issue here that culminated in Watergate. And since Watergate, of course, the press has felt enormously powerful because they toppled. They really did topple a duly elected, widely elected, American president. But I'd like to get back to the Vietnam phenomenon, because by the way, I would like to say, and I think it should be said, that you have done in this book a most admirable and overwhelming job of research and synthesizing all those miserable stories from all those miserable years. It's sort of breathtaking to read the book from that point of view.
It is a big dose of misery, yes.
But there's a cultural issue involved here. Now, you mentioned David Halberstam. David Halberstam was not initially even opposed to the war in Vietnam. He was a foreign correspondent sent there, and clearly he got intoxicated with his own view of Vietnam, and was certainly had a hand in nagging people to do something about Diem, and no doubt made a very serious contribution to the overthrow of Diem. But David Halberstam and Neil Sheehan and all these young reporters came out of a cultural situation in which, without meaning to, they came to assume a skeptical stance vis-a-vis their own government. If you were so innocent and brainwashed as to believe what was being told you in Washington, in the cultural community from which these reporters came, you would be considered incompetent at your job.
Yes, and they were operating during the Kennedy administration and not during the Nixon administration. But this, you see, this is the thing that started me off on taking the time to do this, and it was longer than just the 1 year that it took.
The comparison between Kennedy and Nixon.
The comparison between Kennedy and Nixon. You see, even though Halberstam and Sheehan were working in the Nixon administration, or the Kennedy administration, and they were opposing what was being done, because they knew that soldiers and pilots and helicopter pilots were being sent over there, and they were not supposed to be there. That hadn't been announced. Nobody had said that we were doing that sort of thing. It was they kind of sneaked them in. And they didn't like that. They also didn't like the way the Diem or Diem, whichever pronunciation you didn't like the way the South Vietnamese were running their war. They really seriously thought they could do it better. And worse than that, they blanketed the country with their coverage, because if you take UPI and the New York Times Service, and with Malcolm Brown helping on AP with more or less the same point of view, but not entirely, more or less, the whole United States got one view of Diem. He was painted to be a tyrant and some kind of a monster, whereas before that he had been a good friend and a well-respected leader.
The George Washington of his country.
Yeah. This was an astonishing turnaround that happened there. You know, I mean, such astute people as Bill Malden would go out and draw these perfectly idiotic cartoons, when you look back at them today, about the Diem government at that time. And Marguerite Higgins found that she could not contradict this coalition of the Times and the Wire Services. When the Times and the Wire Services got together on something, Marguerite Higgins, who was probably one of the greatest journalists this country's ever produced, could not hold her own against it at all. About that time was when the Times started to become all-powerful, in part because that same year, the year of that President Diem was killed, the year that President Kennedy was killed, among the other deaths of that year were about half of the newspapers in New York City. And by 66, the New York Herald Tribune went down, and that was it. Then the Times had no more competition at all, and in 1968, the Reporter magazine went under, and that was the last even monthly attempt to contradict the Times. There was no more contradiction going on after that.
Yeah, we began by asking this question. A consensus is formed or is imposed. It was formed on the matter of civil rights. Was it imposed or formed on the matter of Vietnam? I would say that it was formed rather than imposed. After all,
you'd be kind of hair splitting, because here's what happened. What happened was, when you had the tremendous success of someone like David Halberstam, who overnight became a household word and a bestseller and the idol of the other.
But wait a minute, he became a household word when he wrote a book denouncing the people primarily associated with Kennedy.
Yes.
They were the principal victims of that book.
Yes. He was the immediate hero of the pagoda raids. The pagoda raids,
yeah.
Which caused...
he got a Pulitzer Prize for his reporting
in
1960, but he became a household word, I think, when he wrote this very iconoclastic book about the High and the Mighty, and said that all these people like McNamara and Mac George Bundy knew nothing and had gotten America into a terrible mess in Southeast Asia. So I would not say that book reflected any sense of heliocentrism directed at Jack Kennedy.
But you know, he did, in The Making of a Quagmire, which was his book about Vietnam, David Halberstam himself did observe that in Washington, the president got up in the morning and read the New York Times mm-hmm. before he got his own cable mail from around the world.
Most people do that.
And most people do that. And there is this, the story that's told, I think, by Harry McPherson about the Tet Offensive. He said that he came to, because he was then in the Johnson White House, he came to the White House, came to the Situation Room, and would see there reports that Tet was a military victory for our side, and said, I cannot believe this, because that's not what it said in the Times this morning. Now that is really, there's no question that it's massive cultural and political power. My only question is it reflective or is it originative?
This gets to the answer of your question. You see, until Tet, according to Peter Braestrup in Big Story, until Tet in 1968, most of the reporters who were in Vietnam were on our side. We were not on the American journalists were not on the side of the communists over there. They were on the side of the Americans and the South Vietnamese. The only newspaper that opposed the war as such before Tet was the New York Times. But all of those reporters also had learned something in those last 4 years or 5 years since the 63 assassinations and coups. They had learned what how reporters get to be famous, and they all went out on the kinds of stories that had been done previously out of Vietnam by Neil Sheehan and David Halberstam, and many of them wrote a lot of, and a whole lot of books came out on Tet. At that point, the press began to turn very much entirely following the times, dragged along, not led along or lured along, but simply literally almost dragged along. This is sort of an answer to your, this is how I would split the hair of the question
yes.
you asked.
But how?
They were dragged along to say that Tet was a defeat for us. And then the military, and you know, the military is very dumb in public relations. They're pushovers for anybody. Anybody can knock off the military on a public relations basis. And they came along, and some of them were able to prove that, look, it really isn't a military defeat for us. It really was a victory for us. I mean, it was a defeat for us in the sense that we let all those people in Hue be killed, but you guys are not even talking about these people mm-hmm. in Hue who got killed. You don't even mention them.
Mm-hmm.
As a military operation, we won. So then the journalists' minds were by that time made up, and very, very many of them said, well, then it was a psychological defeat for us. A psychological defeat for us, meaning for us journalists. Is what they were saying. It was a psychological defeat for them. And their defeat, their acceptance of being defeated, set the scene or set the stage for a lot of the other things that come in there, like the gross distortion, well, literally the falsification of the Pentagon Papers in the New York Times. Now, here is where the New York Times not only led, but literally corralled the rest of the press and shoved them along. There wasn't any journalist voice in the whole country, so far as one, I think, as I recall.
The Post.
Joe Alsup, maybe.
Oh, yeah.
Who said these Pentagon Papers are a fraud. It couldn't happen the way these people are saying. Documents or no documents. I know documents are very impressive, but this isn't what happened. And it wasn't what happened.
Well, we published, as you remark in your book, we published some fake documents which were widely accepted as legitimate.
Yeah.
Because their existence was presupposed as obvious. But now, wait a minute. Before we get lost in this Vietnam business, I think it's healthy to recall that on a floor fight in the Democratic National Convention, Humphrey beat McCarthy on the question, should we stay in Vietnam? And then Nixon beat Humphrey. And Kissinger, in his own books, I think very eloquently and tragically relates that Nixon's strategy of making one concession after another actually forged our fate, and that when he walked into his own emasculation as president as a result of Watergate, he didn't have the executive power to make the arrangements of Paris stick. So there's a lot that went in there beyond the power of the New York Times. Now, the last thing I want to do is to get the impression that I underestimate the power of the New York Times. I was once asked by Richard Nixon, why was it that I had this specially high opinion of Ronald Reagan? This was 1967. I said, because he's the only man I've ever met who really doesn't care what the New York Times thinks about him. And Nixon said, well, I don't care either. I don't care either. Tell him to John Mitchell. Tell him I don't care. Nothing was more obvious than that he did care. So I don't underestimate for a moment. I'm simply saying that your thesis presupposes a ductility on the part of the American people, which I don't think we finally arrived at. Do you? Really?
No.
I think it presupposes ductility on the part of the American journalism profession in one area,
well,
in the area of foreign affairs.
Yeah,
and I know this to
they
be
control,
true.
They control the Pulitzer Prize. There's no question about that.
I know this. The following to be
but
true.
But Sapphire gets the Pulitzer Prize. George Will gets the Pulitzer Prize.
Yes, but you
but I know the following to be true. I know that in the newspapers that take the New York Times service across the country, every night the Times frontings comes out, and one of the editors in it says, are the frontings in yet? and some copy boy has been told to bring him a list of the stories that are on the front page of the New York Times. I know this happens. I know this happened at the New York Daily News. They would sit up and listen, and someone was assigned to listen to WQXR and take down at 9 o'clock the headlines and the first and the lead stories of the New York Times.
But that's an acknowledgement.
And to match them.
That's an acknowledgement of its seniority earned
it's
by
also,
tradition.
It's also an acknowledgement. That's also saying something
it says that,
terrible about it says American that, newspapers.
It says yeah. that in the area of foreign affairs,
They know what's important.
No, American newspaper editors and radio newsroom editors and television editors recognize that they don't know anything.
Yeah, well,
and
sure,
they accept,
that's
therefore, the New York
that's
Times
true,
point of view.
But there's a sense in which it is self-generating. Walter Cronkite, his famous remark was, "The news is what I say it is." So if he decides to slot a local rape as a lead item, that becomes something that the whole United States pays attention to because of its terrific grip on the 25 million people who watch that news program. By the same token, if this New York Times decides that a coup in Bolivia rates extensive three-column treatment on the right, people think, my God, it's got to be a pretty important coup, right?
Yes.
Even though it's the
yes.
150th coup.
Yes.
And therefore, they simply assume that the research organization of the New York Times gives the Times a leverage on events they don't have. You may remember that in Sunday, when the Soviet tanks overran the freedom fighters in Hungary in 1956, the duty officer of the State Department had to call up the New York Times to find out what was going on. They didn't know. So, but this is hardly something that one can knock the Times for if it's something that they have earned.
I know, and I say they earned it.
Yeah,
I agree
do.
They
yeah,
earned
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah,
I
you give them lots of credit. For
and, I, and I, as I said, I split the blame rather equally between the New York Times and the rest of the press for letting them get away with it. That's what I mean by that. When the Polisario Front has just been admitted to the OAU. Now, we could argue this for a long time. We don't have the time to do it, but I would make the argument that had the New York Times omitted a half dozen editorials that it has written about Polisario and about Morocco, that they might not have been admitted to the OAU. I could make that argument. I might lose the argument, mm-hmm. but I could make the argument.
Mm-hmm. You could make it and still hang on to your credentials.
Yes, I could make it and still hang on to my credentials. I was on vacation in Haiti once, and I picked up the paper in Port-au-Prince, and it says, and the headline says, U.S. Time or New York Times OKs sale of F-15s to Saudis. Mm. You know, the editors down there knew more about foreign affairs than the editors up here did. In Port-au-Prince, they knew more. They knew who decides whether the Saudis could have the F-15s or not.
Well, do you think that we've been shaping this argument about the Times successfully, Ms. Decter?
Well, I think you yourself put your finger on it before on something is very important here. You said the reporters began to understand how you become a best-selling journalist. The reporters in Vietnam, and they began to fall into line. There's no question that there's been a closing of ranks in the American press and media on a lot of issues. But when you say they discovered how it is you become important and best-selling or Pulitzer Prize-winning, what you're actually talking about is the dominant attitudes of the American liberal community, enlightened liberal community at that time. What we mean by the establishment. The way you make a bestseller is that you offer something and there's a constituency that responds to it. And the Times is certainly par excellence, the mouthpiece of this community.
Well, I can't get along without the Times.
Yeah, and if you were in Moscow, you couldn't get along without Izvestia. So let's not repeat that argument. But isn't it also true that, especially in the last 10 or 15 years, the New York Times seems to be actively seeking to challenge itself to be less of an icon? For instance,
yes.
Take the Institute of Policy Studies, by which you devote a lot of space. The big expose of IPS was done in the New York Times. Take the invitation.
Oh, wait, no, it wasn't.
Who did it before?
The Isaac.
Well, been, I mean, well,
no,
we,
no,
we,
no. Earlier than the Isaac's book, there was an article in the New York Times magazine about the IPS. It appeared. Yeah.
That was Josh Muravchik's.
Josh Muravchik's.
There was the Isaacs had done it long before that, but in it, but in small publications that you don't see.
They had
in midstream.
We did it. We did it 10 years ago. We always had the game.
But the midstream article was a absolutely thorough job, and as a matter of fact, it was responded to by IPS, which made it, and then they did it all over again. They did two great stories about it long before the New York Times published it. Yeah. And the New York Times was, in fact, rather backed into a corner where they had to do that.
Well, whatever it is, the fact that they feel this counterforce. For instance, I learned most of what I know about the atrocities in Cambodia from the New York Times. They had extensive coverage of the atrocities in Cambodia, issue after issue
issue.
True. And God knows.
And the boat people, too.
Yeah, that's right. They were the ones who, as recently as a few months ago, bought, which is very unusual for them, a front page story on the plot to kill the Pope. Ran it all over the front page. Very unusual. Bought from Claire Sterling.
Yes.
They're the ones who first published Gulag.
But at the same time, they're the ones who had Harrison Salisbury say that he was the guy who first said, to my knowledge, I believe the first, to say that Andropov was drank scotch and listened to Benny Goodman and was really a friend of the Americans and everything like that, and this thing got picked up all over. And then Hiding Carter got him on a television show, or saying, where did this sort of, on a show exposing some of this kind of nonsense, and who did he choose to be his paid consultant on the show who does this kind of nonsense? Harrison Salisbury. Well, you know, I mean, look at the club is a closed operation.
If you had a few hundred million dollars paid to you by the Kremlin to deploy disinformation, obviously all three of us and all of you would pick the New York Times principal target.
If we could.
Well, we would certainly try.
Yes.
We would certainly try.
Yes.
And any little allurements or seductions, and I don't mean bribery, I simply mean handing you a story about the putative liberalism of Andropov, and you think you got a little scoop, and you squirt a little of this around, and all of a sudden we have a graven image.
But
Andropov,
I
the Scotch drinking, detective reading liberal.
Yes. But I do think it's very important to make certain distinctions. First of all, the editorial and the op-ed page have
different managers.
Entirely, the op-ed page has been absolutely awful. They publish Soviet officials, whom they then counter with journalists, as if these are two balanced opinions.
And Ted Koppel does the same kind of thing. Drives me nuts.
Yes, it's really awful. And they publish pieces written by IPS people all the time, and the IPS is always identified as a liberal think tank in Washington and so on. That's one thing. And I do think there is no question that there have been reporters on the New York Times who have been dreadful and who are revolution lovers, and I will name Raymond Bonner. Mm-hmm. Alan Riding, who is their man in Latin America, stationed in Mexico, and many others.
Well,
and
a couple in Washington have been publishing things like almost the precise number of intelligence people we have in El Salvador, and since there are only, 250 Americans in El Salvador, it sort of narrows it down for assassinations. For the death squads of the other side to pick on, that's probably why that officer was killed in El Salvador shortly after they've given in the Times a number of intelligence people.
Yeah, now I'm 100% on your side on the issue, but in fact it is a universal issue. I've heard people like Fred Friendly, who's patriotism is unquestionable, argue the position that it's the responsibility of a newspaper to release information. Well, you know that old business.
That an interesting question to discuss is the behavior of the press post-Watergate, because Watergate did, it seems to me, did somehow change, strengthen a certain kind of arrogance and high-handedness.
Watergate was a Watergate was to my mind one of the reasons I got into this whole business here is that I did not think that the president should be impeached. I thought that had he not been impeached, that had he not only been given the normal approbation that a president gets for. You know, all of these things were tremendously blown out of, I mentioned the Houston plan being blown out of proportion, but practically everything that was done was blown out of proportion there. Business of a tape gap or something like that, a story that lasted 6 months in the daily newspaper. You can't get a story that lasts 6 months.
That wasn't the point you were about to make. You weren't about
to. Well, there's certainly no question that there was a double standard applied to Watergate. We know that what Nixon did, all his predecessors did,
and successors,
for instance, with the question of these dirty tricks, there was a dirty tricks man in the Kennedy campaign, whose name has slipped my mind at the moment, who was beloved of everybody, and everybody laughed and admired him, and he's admired in David Halberstam's book.
It was a weekly feature in the Village Voice, how funny he was, what had he done that week?
Yes, yeah. Dick Tuck
Dick
was
Tuck,
his
right.
name,
yeah.
right. And he did ghastly things, and so there's no question that there was a double standard applied to...
But that double standard
to
cost
Nixon
us... Well, not too much, perhaps, but look what it cost the people of Southeast Asia. It cost them quite a bit. This is the issue. If Israel had followed the advice given in the New York Times, there would not have been an Israel after 1973. You know, if they'd accepted that advice, if the American government had accepted the advice given by the New York Times in 1970, there probably wouldn't be a king of Jordan anymore. That would probably be...
Well, New York City accepted the advice to vote for Lindsay and went bankrupt.
Yes. Yes, if the United States had accepted all the editorial advice from the New York Times, I'm not sure there'd be a United States.
But Mr. Decter, you were pursuing a point, I think, a little bit independent, which was that the afflatus felt by the press as a result of its success, and never mind the merits of the gesture post-Watergate, caused it to assume a dominant moral posture on all matters.
Yes.
To which we were all supposed to be subservient.
Yes.
I've been to some of you at seminars at which 25 of the world's most illustrious pressmen are asked the question, would you report if you saw a flotilla of Americans heading for Grenada or whatever? And they almost always say, sure, of course we'd report it. Never mind the security of the venture. That assumes a minor priority. And that is definitely post-Watergate, isn't it?
That is the degree of it, the assurance of it is certainly post-Watergate. And also the assumption that the critics of the press are people who are about to snuff out freedom of the First Amendment.
Yeah, fascists.
I mean, you should hear the way they talk about accuracy in media as if the jackboots were
And
that's just because... Asses.
When I went down to Iran to try to cover the Iranian Revolution, I couldn't cover it. I was not allowed to say what I wanted to say. I couldn't get it in the paper, so I tried it as a magazine article. I couldn't get it in a magazine article either.
You mean you couldn't get it in the Daily News?
I couldn't get it in the Daily News, and I couldn't get it into anything else either as a magazine article. I think I sent it to National Review. I couldn't get it in there. So I did I went out to St. Mary's College and gave a speech. Even though I can't speak, I went out and gave a speech about it. The speech got into a book. And I thought, well, if I can get a speech into a book, I can write a book. that is one of the reasons that I wrote a book. But to get to your point about the press arrogance, after a couple of weeks ago, public television had a show about the adventures of a Time magazine correspondent who was allowed on Grenada. And, of course, the press was very put out that it was not allowed to go on Grenada. And this correspondent from Time magazine went up north to see if there was any fighting, and the lieutenant told him that he'd have to leave. He couldn't stay around there. So he went back and he found a captain, and he went into the captain's headquarters and said, look, we got to lay down some ground rules here. And the captain says, you go out and talk to anybody you want to on the street, but get out of my headquarters. You don't have to talk. I'm not going to talk to you. And the Time magazine man said, well, we're both from the same country. And the captain said, no, we're not. And now, I've run into that kind of thing. I've spent half my life overseas. I run into this kind of thing all the time. Naturally, my sympathies should have been with a Time correspondent, right? I found myself rather chuckling and saying, go get him, Captain, you know? And then when I thought about that over again, I was horrified at my own reaction. Mm-hmm. Because the reporters and the soldiers have got to be on the same side. They just have to be. They can't be at each other's throats like that. Now, this is a very terrible thing, and the press has asked for it. It isn't the military that's done this time. Mm-hmm. The military's done enough things in its time, but it isn't the military that's done it this time. It's the journalism fraternity. And the trouble with the journalism fraternity is that it's so much of a fraternity that we all gang together and to hold out off the barbarians.
Well, how do you account for the fraternity you speak of being so markedly hospitable to a number of dissidents, of which I'm one? There are a dozen conservative columnists who fare rather well.
Ah, yes, but only lately. In 1973, if you were looking for a conservative columnist, you might have found yourself, James J. Kilpatrick. I don't know if George Will. I guess George Will maybe then. Right about there, you would run out of conservative columnists in the year 1973.
No, you wouldn't. You had Alexander Holmes. You had Holmes Alexander. You had Stan Evans, you had Ralph Toledano, you had John Chamberlain.
Well, I don't know where they were being printed, but they weren't being printed in places that I could find them. And now...
No, they weren't.
Now, of course.
No, they weren't.
Today, you can't walk down a street without tripping over a conservative columnist. They're all over the place, you know.
How do you account for the difference?
But,
How do you account for the difference?
Well, I think they are now... There have been a few outlets created for them, for one thing. Oddly enough, one of them by the Unification Church, and that's a horrible commentary on our situation. Mm-hmm. The Unification Church had to come to the rest. In Washington,
the Washington Times... But also the op-ed page of the New York Times got Sapphire started.
Yeah, but Sapphire was a fig leaf because they needed somebody who was conservative around there. They had to have one someplace.
I think the real question is how many young conservatives would get jobs as reporters with bylines.
Yeah. Well, naturally, everybody
yeah, like say many, on the New York
how
Times.
How many would get promoted to tenure in a faculty, for instance?
Yes. Yeah, that's another question.
Yeah, if they're. Well, we know from that Lichter and Rothman study, I have the figures here, that the people attached to the media conspicuously voted 6 for Goldwater, 94 for Johnson, 13 for Nixon, 87 for Humphrey, 19 for Nixon, 81 for McGovern, 19 for Ford, 81 for Carter, which, to the extent that these things betray anything, betrays what the political sympathies are.
81 for McGovern is
yeah,
a very serious figure.
When the country was going
figure.
About 61 for Nixon.
Well, anybody who gets into journalism as a young man is probably going to be a liberal sort of idealist. You don't have very many idealists who want to go out and defend the Herbert Hoover administration or want to find reasons for Nixon not to have been guilty at Watergate. You don't find many like that at young people. That's normal. We all started off that way, but some of us have got to change.
But didn't the recent elections show that among young people there is an appetite for idealism and an appetite for researching tradition and trying to find nourishment in it? My son was 25 years old, was made the managing editor of Esquire, and he calls himself a right-wing nut. I'm not suggesting that the politics of Esquire became conservative. But I'm saying that it's not entirely closed out.
No, not entirely. I mean, but generally speaking, most journalists are, young journalists are liberal idealists, I should say.
But that's true of the whole vocal class, isn't it, Midge?
Yes, but it certainly is, except that I take exception to the word idealism. They are liberal...
ideologues.
In many cases, ideologues. And among the reporters who are not ideologues, they are people who assume an adversarial stance, who have a politics without even knowing that it's a politics. They just think that all right-thinking, good, decent people agree with them about everything, which isn't quite the same thing as being an ideologue. But it is. There is a kind of assumption. I guess you learn it in university, and then it's certainly reconfirmed in journalism school, that the only quotes idealistic posture you can be in is to stand in an adversarial relation to your own country.
Thank you very much, Midge Decter. Thank you very much, Mr. Russ Braley, author of Bad News, the Foreign Policy of the New York Times. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of Oratory Preparatory in Summit, New Jersey.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.